The following is a free for download audiobook from the website krishnapath.org. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 7, Part 3, Chapter 13, The Behavior of a Perfect Person. This 13th chapter describes the regulative principles for the sannyasis and also describes the history of an avaduta. It concludes with a description of perfection for the student in spiritual advancement. Sri Narada Muni has been describing the symptoms of various ashrams and varnas. Now, in this chapter, he specifically describes the regulative principles to be followed by sannyasis. After retiring from family life, one should accept the status of vanaprast, in which he must formally accept the body as his means of existence, but gradually forget the bodily necessities of life. After vanaprast life, having left home, one should travel to different places as sannyasi. Without bodily comforts and free from dependence on anyone with respect to bodily necessities, one should travel everywhere wearing almost nothing or actually walking naked. Without association with ordinary human society, one should beg alms and always be satisfied in himself. One should be a friend to every living entity and be very peaceful in Krishna consciousness. A sannyasi should travel alone in this way, not caring for life or death, waiting for the time when he will leave his material body. He should not indulge in unnecessary books or adopt professions like astrology, nor should he try to become a great orator. He should also give up the path of unnecessary argument and should not depend on anyone under any circumstances. He should not try to allure people into becoming his disciples just so that the number of his disciples may increase. He should give up the habit of reading many books as a means of livelihood, and he should not attempt to increase the number of temples and mutts or monasteries. When a sannyasi thus becomes completely independent, peaceful, and equipoised, he can select the destination he desires after death and follow the principles by which to reach that destination. Although fully learned, he should always remain alert, like a dumb person, and travel like a restless child. In this regard, Narada Muni described a meeting between Prahlad and a saintly person who had adopted the mode of life of a python. In this way, he described the symptoms of a paramahansa. A person who has attained the paramahansa stage knows very well the distinction between matter and spirit. He is not at all interested in gratifying the material senses, for he is always deriving pleasure from devotional service to the Lord. He is not very anxious to protect his material body. Being satisfied with whatever he attains by the grace of the Lord, he is completely independent of material happiness and distress, and thus he is transcendental to all regulative principles. Sometimes he accepts severe austerities, and sometimes he accepts material opulence. His only concern is to satisfy Krishna, and for that purpose he can do anything and everything without reference to the regulative principles. He is never to be equated with materialistic men, nor is he subject to the judgments of such men. Text 1. Sri Narada Muni said, "A person able to cultivate spiritual knowledge should renounce all material connections, and merely keeping the body inhabitable, he should travel from one place to another, passing only one night in each village. In this way, without dependence in regards to the needs of the body, the sannyasi should travel all over the world." Text 2. "A person in the renounced order of life may try to avoid even a dress to cover himself. If he wears not anything at all, it should be only a loincloth, and when there is no necessity, a sannyasi should not even accept a danda. A sannyasi should avoid carrying anything but a danda and kamandalu." Text 3. "The sannyasi, being completely satisfied in the self, should live on alms begged from door to door. Not being dependent on any person or any place, he should always be a friendly well-wisher to all living beings and be a peaceful, unalloyed devotee of Narayan. In this way, he should move from one place to another." Text 4. "The sannyasi should always try to see the Supreme pervading everything and see everything, including this universe, resting on the Supreme." Text 5. during consciousness and unconsciousness and between the two, he should try to understand the self and be fully situated in the self. In this way, he should realize that the conditioned soul, conditioned and liberated stages of life are only illusory and are not actually factual. With such a higher understanding, he should see only the absolute truth pervading everything. Purport. The unconscious state is nothing but ignorance, darkness, or material existence, and in the conscious state one is awake. The marginal state between consciousness and unconsciousness has no permanent existence. Therefore, one who is advanced in understanding the self should understand that unconsciousness and consciousness are but illusions, for they fundamentally do not exist. Only the Supreme Absolute Truth exists, as confirmed by the Lord in Bhagavad Gita 9.4. Maya tatamidam sarvam jagat avyaktir murtina matstani sarvabhutani nachaham tveshnavasita. Quote, by me and my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them. End quote. Everything exists on the basis of Krishna's impersonal feature. Nothing can exist without Krishna. Therefore, the advanced devotee of Krishna can see the Lord everywhere without illusion. Text 7. Since the material body is sure to be vanquished and the duration of one's life is not fixed, neither death nor life is to be praised. Rather, one should observe the eternal time factor in which the living entity manifests himself and disappears. Purport. The living entity in the material world, not only at present but also in the past, have been involved in trying to solve the problems of birth and death. Some stress death and point to the illusory existence of everything immaterial, whereas others stress life, trying to preserve it perpetually and enjoy it to the best of their ability. Both of them are fools and rascals. It is advised that one observe the eternal time factor, which is the cause of the material body's appearance and disappearance, and that one observe the living entity's entanglement in this time factor. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur therefore sings in his Gitavali, Anadi karma phale pade bhavarnava jale tadi bade na deki upaya. One should observe the activities of eternal time, which is the cause of birth and death. Before the creation of the present millennium, the living entities were under the influence of the time factor, and within the time factor, the material world comes into existence and is again annihilated. Bhutva bhutva praliyate. Being under the control of the time factor, the living entities appear and die, life after life. This time factor is the impersonal realization or representation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who gives the living entities conditioned by material nature a chance to emerge from this nature by surrendering to him. Text 7. Literature that is a useless waste of time, in other words, literature without spiritual benefit, should be rejected. One should not become a professional teacher as a means of earning one's livelihood, nor should one indulge in arguments and counterarguments. Nor should one take shelter of any cause or faction. Purport. A person desiring to advance in spiritual understanding should be extremely careful to avoid reading ordinary literature. The world is full of ordinary literature that creates unnecessary agitation in the mind. Such literature, including newspapers, dramas, novels, and magazines, is factually not meant for the advancement in spiritual knowledge. Indeed, it has been described as a place of enjoyment for crows. Tadvyasham Tirtam. Anyone advancing in spiritual knowledge must reject such literature. Furthermore, one should not concern oneself with the conclusions of various logicians and philosophers. Of course, those who preach sometimes need to argue with the contentions of opponents, but as much as possible, one should avoid an argumentative attitude. In this connection, Srila Madhvacharya says, Aprayajan proktam nas samshayet na prayojana pakshishan na vrita sishya bandakrit na chadasina shastani na virudani chabyaset na vyakta Yayopad Jivita Na Siddhan Samacharet Evam Bhuto Yati Yati Tat Eka Sarano Harim. Quote, "There is no need to take shelter of unnecessary literature or concern oneself with so many philosophers and thinkers who are useless for spiritual advancement, nor should one accept a disciple for the sake of fashion or popularity. One should be callous to these so-called shastras, neither opposing nor favoring them, and one should not earn one's livelihood by taking money for explaining shastra. A sannyasi must always be neutral and seek the means to advance in spiritual life, taking full shelter under the lotus feet of the Lord." Text 8. "A sannyasi must not present allurements of material benefits to gather many disciples, nor should he unnecessarily read many books or give discourses as a means of livelihood. He must never attempt to increase material opulences unnecessarily." Purport. So-called swamis and yogis generally make disciples by alluring them with material benefits. There are many so-called gurus who attract disciples by promising to cure their diseases or increase their material opulence by manufacturing gold. These are lucrative allurements for unintelligent men. A sannyasi is prohibited from making disciples through such material allurements. Sannyasis sometimes indulge in material opulence by unnecessarily constructing many temples and monasteries, but actually such endeavors should be avoided. Temples and monasteries should be constructed for the preaching of spiritual consciousness or Krishna consciousness, not to provide free hotels for persons who are useful for neither material or spiritual purposes. Temples and monasteries should be strictly off limits to worthless clubs of crazy men. In the Krishna conscious movement, we welcome everyone who agrees at least to follow the movement's regulative principles: no illicit sex, no intoxication, no meat eating, and no gambling. In temples and monasteries, gatherings of unnecessary, rejected, lazy fellows should be strictly disallowed. The temples and monasteries should be used exclusively by devotees who are serious about spiritual advancement in Krishna consciousness. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur explains the word Aramban as meaning Matadi Vyaparan, which means, quote, attempts to construct temples and monasteries, end quote. The first business of the sannyasi is to preach Krishna consciousness. But if, by the grace of Krishna, facilities are available, then he may construct temples and monasteries to give shelter to the serious students of Krishna consciousness. Otherwise, such temples and monasteries are not needed. Text 9. A peaceful, equipoised person who is factually advanced in spiritual consciousness does not need to accept the symbols of a sannyasi, such as the tridanda and kamandalu. According to necessity, he may sometimes accept those symbols and sometimes reject them. Purport. There are four stages of the renounced order of life: Kudichak, Bhavadak, Parivarjakacharya, and Paramahansa. Herein, Srimad Bhagavatam considers the Paramahansas among the sannyasis. The Mayavadi impersonalist sannyasis cannot attain the Paramahansa stage. This is because of their impersonal conception of the Absolute Truth. Brahmeti Paramatmeti Bhagavan Niti Subdite. The Absolute Truth is perceived in three stages, of which Bhagavan, the realization of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is meant for the Paramahansas. Indeed, Srimad Bhagavatam itself is meant for the Paramahansas. Paramo Nirmatsaranam Satam. Unless one is in the Paramahansa stage, he is not eligible to understand the Srimad Bhagavatam. For Paramahansas, or sannyasis in the Vaishnava order, preaching is the first duty. To preach, such sannyasis may accept the symbols of sannyas, such as the danda and kamandalu, or sometimes they may not. Generally, the Vaishnava sannyasis, being Paramahansas, are automatically called babajis, and they do not carry a kamandalu or danda. Such a sannyasi is free to accept or reject the marks of sannyas. His only thought is, quote, where is an opportunity to spread Krishna consciousness, end quote. Sometimes the Krishna conscious movement sends its representative sannyasis to foreign countries where the danda and kamandalu are not very much appreciated. We send our preachers in ordinary dress to introduce our books and philosophy. Our only concern is to attract people to Krishna consciousness. We may do this in the dress of sannyasis or in the regular dress of gentlemen. Our only concern is to spread interest in Krishna consciousness. Text 10. Although a saintly person may not expose himself to the vision of human society, by his behavior his purpose is disclosed. To human society he should present himself like a restless child, and although he is the greatest thoughtful orator, he should present himself like a dumb man. Purport. A great personality very much advanced in Krishna consciousness may not expose himself by the signs of a sannyasi. To cover himself, he may live like a restless child or a dumb person, although he is the greatest orator or poet. Text 11. As an historical example of this, learned sages recite the story of an ancient discussion between Prahlad Maharaj and a great saintly person who was feeding himself like a python. Purport. The saintly person met by Prahlad Maharaj was undergoing ajagara vritti, the living conditions of a python, which does not go anywhere, but he sits in one place for years and eats whatever is automatically available. Prahlad Maharaj, along with his associates, met this great saint and spoke with him as follows. Text 12 and 13. Prahlad Maharaj, the most dear servitor of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, went out touring the universe with some of his confidential associates just to study the nature of saintly persons. Thus, he arrived at the bank of the Kaveri, where there was a mountain known as Saya. There he found a great saintly person who was lying on the ground, covered with dirt and dust, but who was deeply spiritually advanced. Text 14. Neither that by that saintly person's activities, by his bodily features, by his words, nor by the symptoms of his varnashram status, could people understand whether he was the same person they had known. Purport. The inhabitants of that particular place in the bank of the Kaveri, in the valley of the mountain known as Saya, were unable to understand whether that saint was the same man they had known. It is therefore said, Vaishnavera Kriya Mudra Nivigne Na Pujaya. A highly advanced Vaishnava lives in such a way that no one can understand what he is or what he was. Nor should attempts be made to understand the past of a Vaishnava. Without asking the saintly person about his previous life, Prahlad Maharaj immediately offered him respectful obeisances. Text 15. The advanced devotee Prahlad Maharaj duly worshipped and offered obeisances to the saintly person who had adopted the python's means of livelihood. After thus worshipping the saintly person and touching his own head to the saint's lotus feet, Prahlad Maharaj, in order to understand him, inquired very submissively as follows. Text 16 and 17. Seeing the saintly person to be quite fit, Prahlad Maharaj said, My dear sir, you undergo no endeavor to earn your livelihood, but you have a stout body exactly like that of a materialistic enjoyer. I know that if one is very rich and has nothing to do, he becomes extremely fat by eating and sleeping and performing no work. Purport. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur did not like his disciples to become very fat in the due course of time. He would become very anxious upon seeing his fat disciples becoming bogies or enjoyers of the senses. This attitude is herewith confirmed by Prahlad Maharaj, who was surprised to see a saintly person adopting ajagara vritti and becoming very fat. In the material world also, we generally see that when a man who is poor and skinny gradually endeavors to earn money through business or some other means, he then gets the money, he enjoys his senses to his satisfaction. By enjoying the senses, one becomes fat. Therefore, in spiritual advancement, becoming fat is not at all satisfactory. Text 18. O Brahmana, fully in knowledge of transcendence, you have nothing to do, and therefore you're lying down. It is also understood that you have no money for sense enjoyment. How then has your body become so fat? It's under the circumstances, if you do not consider my question impudent, kindly explain how this has happened. Purport. Generally, those engaged in spiritual advancement take food only once, either in the afternoon or in the evening. If one takes food only once, naturally he does not become fat. The learned sage, however, was quite fat, and therefore Prahlad Maharaj was very much surprised. Because of being experienced in self-realization, a transcendentalist certainly becomes bright-faced, and one who is advanced in self-realization must be considered to possess the body of a brahmana. Because the bright-faced saintly person was lying down and not working and yet was quite fat, Prahlad Maharaj was puzzled and wanted to question him about this. Text 19. Your honor appears learned, expert, and intelligent in every way. You can speak very nicely, saying things that are pleasing to the heart. You see that people in general are engaged in fruitive activities, yet you are lying here inactive. Purport. Prahlad Maharaj studied the bodily features of the saintly person, and through the saint's physiognomy, Prahlad Maharaj could understand that he was intelligent and expert, although he was lying down and not doing anything. Prahlad was naturally inquisitive about why he was lying there inactive. Text 20. Narada Muni continued, when the saintly person was thus questioned by Prahlad Maharaj, the king of the Daityas, he was captivated by this shower of nectarian words, and he replied to the inquisitiveness of Prahlad Maharaj with a smiling face. Text 21. The saintly brahmana said, O best of the asuras, Prahlad Maharaj, who are recognized by advanced and civilized men, you are aware of the different stages of life because of your inherent transcendental eyes, with which you can see a man's character and thus know clearly the results of acceptance and rejection of things as they are. Purport. A pure devotee like Prahlad Maharaj can understand the minds of others because of his pure vision in devotional service. A devotee like Prahlad Maharaj can study another man's character without difficulty. Text 22. Narayan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is full in all opulences, is predominant within the core of your heart because of your being a pure devotee. He always drives away all the darkness of ignorance, just as the sun drives away the darkness of the universe. Purport. The words Bhaktya Kevalaya indicate that simply by executing devotional service, one can become full of all knowledge. Krishna is the master of all knowledge. Aishvaryasya Samagrasya Viryasya Yashasya Shya. The Lord is situated in everyone's heart. Ishvara Sarvabhutanam Hridyesha Arjuna Tisthati. And when the Lord is pleased with a devotee, the Lord instructs him. Only to the devotees, however, does the Lord give instructions by which to advance further and further in devotional service. To others, the non-devotees, the Lord gives instructions according to the manner of their surrender. The pure devotee is described by the words Bhaktya Kevala, or Kevalaya. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur explains that Bhaktya Kevalaya means Gyanakarmadi Anashimshaya, quote, unmixed with fruitive activities or speculative knowledge, end quote. Simply surrendering at the lotus feet is the cause of all a devotee's enlightenment and awareness. Text 23. My dear king, although you know everything, you have posed some questions, which I shall try to answer according to what I have learned by hearing from authorities. I cannot remain silent in this regard, for a personality like you is just fit to be spoken to by one who desires self-purification. Purport. A saintly person doesn't wish to speak to anyone and everyone, and he is therefore grave and silent. Generally, a common man does not need to be advised. Unless one is prepared to take instructions, it is said that a saintly person should not address him, although sometimes, because of great kindness, a saintly person speaks to ordinary men. As for Prahlad Maharaj, however, since he was not a common ordinary man, whatever questions he posed would have to be answered even by a great and exalted personality. Therefore, the saintly brahmana did not remain silent, but began to answer. These answers, however, were not concocted by him. This is indicated by the words, yata shrutam, meaning, quote, as I have heard from the authorities, end quote. In the parampara system, when the questions are bona fide, the answers are bona fide. No one should attempt to create or manufacture answers. One must refer to the Shastras and give answers according to Vedic understanding. The words yata shrutam refer to Vedic knowledge. The Vedas are known as Shruti because this knowledge is received from authorities. These statements of the Vedas are known as Shruti Pramana. One should quote evidence from the Shruti, the Vedas, or Vedic literature, and then one's statements will be correct. Otherwise, one's words will proceed from mental concoction. Text 24. Because of insatiable material desires, I was being carried away by the waves of material nature's laws, and thus I was engaging in different activities, struggling for existence in various forms of life. Purport. As long as a living entity wants to fulfill various types of material desire, he must continually change from one body to accept another. Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur explains that there is a small piece of grass. As a small piece of grass falls in a river and is tossed about with different types of wood and tree branches, the living entity floats in the ocean of material existence and is dashed and tossed amid material conditions. This is called the struggle for existence. One kind of fruitive activity causes the living being to take one form of body, and because of actions performed in that body, another body is created. One must therefore stop these material activities, and the chance to do so is given in the human form of life. Specifically, our energy should be to engage in the service of the Lord, for then all materialistic activities will automatically stop. One must fulfill one's desires by surrendering unto the Supreme Lord, for if he knows how to fulfill them, even though one may have material desires, one should therefore engage in the devotional service of the Lord. That will purify one's struggle for existence. Akama savakamova moksha kama udaradi tivrena bhakti yogena yajeta purusham param. Quote, a person who has broader intelligence, whether he be full of all material desire, without any material desire, or desiring liberation, must by all means worship the Supreme Whole, the Personality of Godhead. End quote. Srimad Bhagavatam 2.3.10. Anya bilashita sunyam gyana karmadi anavritam alakunyena krishnanu shilanam bhakti rutama. Quote, one should render transcendental loving service to the Supreme Lord Krishna favorably and without desire for material profit or gain through fruitive activities or philosophical speculation. That is called pure devotional service. End quote. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 1.1.11. Text 25. In the course of the evolutionary process, which is caused by fruitive activities due to undesirable material sense gratification, I have received this human form of life, which can lead to the heavenly planets, to liberation, to the lower species, or to rebirth among human beings. Purport. All living entities within this material world are undergoing the cycle of birth and death according to the laws of nature. This struggle of birth and death in different species may be called the evolutionary process, but in the Western world, it has been wrongly explained. Darwin's theory of evolution from animal to man is incomplete because the theory does not present the reverse condition, namely evolution from man to animal. In this verse, however, evolution has been very well explained on the strength of Vedic authority. Human life, which is obtained in the course of the evolutionary process, is a chance for elevation, svarbha purvarga, or degradation, tirascham punar asyacha. If one uses this human form of life properly, he can elevate himself to the higher planetary systems, where material happiness may is many thousands of times better than on this planet, or one may cultivate knowledge by which to become free from the evolutionary process and be reinstated in one's original spiritual life. That is called apavarga, or liberation. Material life is called pavarga because here we are subject to five different states of suffering, represented by the letters pa, fa, ba, and ma. Pa means parishrama, very hard labor. Fa means fena, or foam from the mouth. For example, sometimes we see a horse foaming at the mouth with heavy labor. Ba means byatata, or disappointment. In spite of so much hard labor, at the end we find disappointment. Bha means baya, or fear. In material life, one is always in the blazing fire of fear, since no one knows what will happen next. Finally, ma means mrityu, or death. When one attempts to nullify these five different statuses of life, pa, pha, ba, baha, and ma, one achieves apavarga, or liberation from the punishment of material existence. The word tirashtram refers to degraded life. Human life, of course, provides an opportunity for the best living conditions. As Western people think, from the monkeys come the human beings, who are more comfortably situated. However, if one does not utilize this human life for svarga or apavarga, he falls again to the degraded life of animals like dogs and hogs. Therefore, a sane human being must consider whether he will elevate himself to the higher planets, prepare to free himself from the evolutionary process, or travel again through the evolutionary process in higher or and lower grades of life. If one works piously, one may be elevated to the higher planetary systems and achieve liberation and return home back to Godhead. But otherwise, one may be degraded to a life as a dog, a hog, and so on. As explained in Bhagavad Gita 9.25, Yanti Deva Vrata Devan. Those interested in being elevated to the higher planetary systems, Devaloka or Svargaloka, must prepare to do so. Similarly, if one wants liberation and wants to return home, back to Godhead, he should prepare himself for that purpose. Our Krishna consciousness movement is therefore the highest movement for the benediction of human society because this movement is teaching people how to go back home, back to Godhead. In Bhagavad Gita 13.22, it is clearly stated that different forms of life are obtained by association with the three modes of material nature. Karnam guna sangosya sadasadyona jamnishu. According to one's association with material qualities of goodness, passion, and ignorance in this life, in one's next life, one receives an appropriate body. Modern civilization does not know that because of varied association in material nature, the living entity, though although eternal, is placed in different diseased conditions known as the many species of life. Modern civilization is unaware of the laws of nature. Prakriti kriyamana nigune karmani sarvasha hankara vimudatma karte mamiti manite. Quote, the bewildered spirit soul, under the influence of the three modes of material nature, thinks himself the performer of activities that are in actuality carried out by nature. End quote. Bhagavad Gita 3.27. Every living entity is under the full control of the stringent laws of material nature, but rascals think themselves independent. Actually, however, they cannot be independent. This is foolishness. A foolish civilization is extremely risky, and therefore the Krishna consciousness movement is trying to make people aware of their fully dependent condition upon the stringent laws of nature and is trying to save them from being victimized by strong Maya, which is Krishna's external energy. Behind the material laws is the supreme controller, Krishna. Maya dakshena prakritik suyatesha characharam. Therefore, if one surrenders unto Krishna, Maya mevatara. Ye papadyante mayametam tatantite, one may immediately become free from the control of external energy. Sargunan samadityaitan brahmubhuyai kalpate. This should be the aim of life. Text 26. In this human form of life, a man and woman unite for the sensual pleasure of sex, but by actual experience we have observed that none of them are happy. Therefore, seeing the contrary results, I have stopped taking part in materialistic activities. Purport. As stated by Prahlad Maharaj, Yan maitunadi grihimedi sukami tu chum. Man and woman both seek sexual enjoyment, and when they are united by the ritualistic ceremony of marriage, they are happy for some time, but finally there is dissension, and thus there are so many cases of separation and divorce. Although every man and woman is actually eager to enjoy life through sexual unity, the result is disunity and distress. Marriage is recommended to give men and women concession for restricted sex life, which is also recommended in Bhagavad Gita by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Dharma virudho bhuteshu kamo smi. Sex life, not against the principle of religion, is Krishna. Every living entity is always eager to enjoy sex life because materialistic life consists of eating, sleeping, sex, and fear. In animal life, eating, sleeping, sexual enjoyment, and fear cannot be regulated, But for human society, the plan is that although men, and like animals, must be allowed to eat, sleep, and enjoy sex and take protection from fear, they must be regulated. The Vedic plan for eating recommends that one take yajna shista, or prasad, food offered to Krishna. Yajna shista sina santo muchyanti sarva kilibasai. Quote, the devotees of a Lord are released from all kinds of sin because they eat food that is first offered for sacrifice, end quote, by Gita 3.13. In material life, one commits sinful activities, especially in eating, and because of sinful activities, one is condemned by nature's laws to accept another material body, which is imposed as punishment. Sex and eating are essential, and therefore they are offered to human society under Vedic restrictions so that, according to the Vedic injunctions, people may eat, sleep, enjoy sex, and be protected from fearful life, and gradually be elevated and liberated from the punishment of material existence. Thus, the Vedic injunctions for marriage offers a concession to human society, the idea that a man and woman united in ritualistic marriage ceremony should help one another advance in spiritual life. Unfortunately, especially in this age, men and women unite for unrestricted sexual enjoyment. Thus, they are victimized, being obliged to take rebirth in the forms of animals to fulfill their animalistic propensities. The Vedic injunctions therefore warn, Nayam deha deha bajam niloki kashtan kaman ardit hate vid bijumye. One should not enjoy sex life like hogs and eat everything, even to the limits of stool. A human being should eat prasad, offered to the deity, and should enjoy sex life according to the Vedic injunctions. He should engage himself in the business of Krishna consciousness, and he should save himself from the fearful condition of material existence, and he should sleep only to recover from fatigue due to working hard. The learned Brahmana said that since everything is misused by fruitive workers, he had retired from all fruitive activities. Text 27. The actual form of life for the living entities is one of spiritual happiness, which is real happiness. This happiness can be achieved only when one stops all materialistic activities. Material sense enjoyment is simply imagination. Therefore, considering this subject matter, I've ceased from all material activities and I'm lying down here. Purport. The difference between the Mayavadi philosophy and that of the Vaishnavas is explained herein. Both the Mayavadis and Vaishnavas know that in materialistic activities there is no happiness. The Mayavadi philosophers, therefore, adhering to the slogan Brahma Satyam Jagan Mitya, want to refrain from false materialistic activities. They want to stop all activities and merge in the Supreme Brahman. According to the Vaishnava philosophy, however, if one simply ceases from materialistic activity, one cannot remain inactive for a very long time, and therefore everyone should engage himself in spiritual activities which will solve the problem of suffering in this material world. It is said, therefore, that although the Mayavadi philosophers strive to refrain from the materialist activities and merge in Brahman, and although they may actually merge in Brahman existence, for want of activity they fall down again to materialistic activity. Ayuna krachena parampadam tata parantyada. Thus, the so-called renouncer, unable to remain in meditation upon Brahman, returns to materialistic activities by opening hospitals and schools and so on. Therefore, by simply cultivating knowledge that materialist activities cannot give one happiness and that one should consequently cease from such activities is insufficient. One should cease from materialistic activities and take up spiritual activities. Then the solution to the problem will be achieved. Spiritual activities are activities performed according to the order of Krishna. Anukulyena Krishnanu Shilanam. If one does whatever Krishna says, his activities are not material. For example, when Arjuna fought in response to the order of Krishna, his activities were not material. Fighting for sense gratification is a materialistic activity, but fighting by the order of Krishna is spiritual. By spiritual activities, one is eligible to go back home, back to Godhead, and then enjoy a blissful life eternally. Here, in the material world, everything is but a mental concoction that will never give us real happiness. The practical solution, therefore, is to cease from material activities and engage in spiritual activities. Yajnartat kamanonyatra lokoyam karma bandhana. If one works for the sake of pleasing the Supreme Lord, Yajna or Vishnu, one is in liberated life. If one fails to do so, however, he remains in a life of bondage. Text 28. In this way, the conditioned soul living within the body forgets his self-interest because he identifies himself with the body. Because the body is material, his natural tendency is to be attracted by the varieties of the material world. Thus, the living entity suffers the miseries of material existence. Purport. Everyone is trying to be happy because, as explained in the previous verse, Sukham asyatmano rupam sarve ho paritas tuna. When the living entity is in his original spiritual form, he is happy by nature. There is no question of miseries for the spiritual being. As Krishna is always happy, the living entities who are his parts and parcels are also happy by nature. But because they are of being put in this material world and forgetting their eternal relationship with Krishna, they have forgotten their real nature. Because every one of us is part of Krishna, we have a very affectionate relationship with him. But because we have forgotten our identities and are considering the body to be the self, we are afflicted by all the troubles of birth, death, old age, and disease. This misconception in materialistic life continues unless and until one comes to understand his relationship with Krishna. The happiness sought by the conditioned soul is certainly only illusion, as explained in the next verse. Text 29. Just as a deer, because of ignorance, cannot see the water within a well covered by grass, but runs after water elsewhere, the living entity covered by the material body does not see the happiness within himself, but runs after happiness in the material world. Purport. This is an accurate example depicting how the living entity, because of lack of knowledge, runs after happiness outside his own self. When one understands his real identity as a spiritual being, he can understand the supreme spiritual being, Krishna, and the real happiness exchanged between Krishna and one's self. It is very interesting to note how this verse points to the body's growth from the spiritual soul. The modern materialistic scientist thinks that life grows from matter, but actually the fact is that matter grows from life. The life, or the spiritual soul, is compared herein to water, from which clumps of matter grow in the form of grass. One who is ignorant of scientific knowledge of the spirit soul does not look inside the body to find happiness in the soul. Instead, he goes outside to search for happiness, just as a deer without knowledge of water beneath the grass goes out to the desert to find water. The Krishna consciousness movement is trying to remove the ignorance of misled human beings who are trying to find water outside the jurisdiction of life. Raso vaisa, rasoham apsu konteya. The taste of water is Krishna. To quench one's thirst, one must taste water by association with Krishna. This is the Vedic injunction. Text 30. The living entity tries to achieve happiness and rid himself of the causes of distress, but because the various bodies of the living entities are under the control of material nature, all his plans in different bodies, one after another, are ultimately baffled. Purport. Because the materialist is in gross ignorance of how the laws of material nature act upon him as a result of his fruitive activity, he mistakenly plans to enjoy bodily comfort in the human form of life through so-called economic development, through pious activities for elevation to higher planetary systems, and in many other ways. But factually, he becomes a victim of the reactions of his fruitive activities. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is situated as the Supersoul within the cores of the hearts of all living entities. As the Lord says in Bhagavad Gita 15:15, Sarvasya chahamri disanavistoma tismiti garamapohanam cha. Quote, I am seated in everyone's heart, and from me come remembrance, knowledge, and forgetfulness. End quote. The desires and activities of the living beings are observed by the Supersoul, who is Upadrasta, or the overseer, and who orders material nature to fulfill the various desires of a living being, as clearly stated in Bhagavad Gita 18:61. Ishvara sarva bhutanam hridayeshu arjuna tisthati brahmanyam sarva bhutani yantarudrani mayaya. The Lord is situated in everyone's heart, and as one desires, the Lord gives one various types of bodies which are like machines. Riding on such a machine, the living entity wanders throughout the universe under the control of material nature and its modes. Thus, the living being is not at all free to act, but is fully under the control of material nature, which is fully under the control of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. As soon as a living entity is victimized by material desires to lord over material nature, he is subjected to the control of material nature, which is supervised by the Supreme Soul. The result is that one again and again makes plans and is baffled, but as foolish as he is, he cannot see the cause of his bafflement. This cause is distinctly stated in Bhagavad Gita. Because one has not surrendered to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he must work under the control of material nature and its stringent laws. The only means of becoming free from this entanglement is to surrender to the Supreme Lord. In the human form of life, the living entity must accept this instruction from the Supreme Person, Krishna. Sarva dharman paricchaja mamikam sharanamaja. Quote, do not plan to achieve happiness and drive away distress. You will never be successful. Simply surrender unto me. End quote. Unfortunately, however, the living entity does not accept the Supreme Lord's clearly stated instructions from Bhagavad Gita, and thus he becomes a perpetual captive of the laws of material nature. Yagnartat karmino nyatra lokayam karma bandhana. If one does not act for the satisfaction of Krishna, who is known as Vishnu or Jaga, he must be entangled in the reactions of fruitive activities. These reactions are called papa and punya, sinful and pious. By pious activities, one is elevated to higher planetary systems, and by impious activities, one is degraded to lower species of life, in which he is punished by the laws of nature. In the lower species of life, there is an evolutionary process, and when the term of the living entity's imprisonment or punishment in the lower species is finished, he is again offered a human form and given a chance to decide for himself which way he should plan. If he again misses the opportunity, he is again put into the cycle of birth and death, sometimes going higher and sometimes lower, turning on the samsara chakra, the wheel of material existence. As a wheel sometimes goes up and sometimes comes down, the stringent laws of material nature make the living entity in material existence sometimes happy and sometimes distressed. How he suffers in the cycle of happiness and distress is described in the next verse. Text 31. Materialistic activities are always mixed with three kinds of miserable conditions, adhyatmika, adhidaivika, and adhibodhika. Therefore, even if one achieves some success by performing such activities, what is the benefit of this success? One is still subjected to birth, death, old age, and disease, and the reactions of his fruitive activities. Purport. According to the materialistic way of life, if a poor man, after laboring very, very hard, gets some material profit at the end of his life, he is considered a success, although, even though he again dies while suffering the threefold miseries, adhyatmika, adhidaivika, and adhibodhika. No one can escape the threefold miseries of materialistic life, namely miseries pertaining to the body and mind, miseries pertaining to the difficulties imposed by society, community, nation, and other living entities, and miseries inflicted upon us by natural disturbances from earthquakes, famines, droughts, floods, epidemics, and so on. If one works very hard, suffering the threefold miseries, and is then successful in getting some small benefit, what is the value of this benefit? Besides that, even if a karmi is successful in accumulating some material wealth, he still cannot enjoy it, for he must die in bereavement. I've even seen a dying man begging a medical attendant to increase his life by 4 years so that he could complete his material plans. Of course, the medical man was unable in expanding the life of the man, who therefore died in great bereavement. Everyone must die in this way, and after one's mental condition is taken into account by the laws of material nature, he is given another chance to fulfill his desires in a different body. Material plans for material happiness have no value, but under the spell of the illusory energy, we consider them extremely valuable. There were many politicians, social reformers, and philosophers who died very miserably without deriving any practical value from their material plans. Therefore, a sane and sensible man never desires to work hard under the conditions of threefold miseries, only to die in disappointment. Text 32. The Brahmana continued, I am actually seeing how a rich man, who is the victim of his senses, is very greedy to accumulate wealth, and therefore suffers from insomnia due to fear from all sides, despite his wealth and opulence. Purport. Greedy capitalists accumulate money under so many miserable conditions, and the result being that because they collect money by questionable means, their minds are always agitated. Thus, they are unable to sleep at night, and they have to take pills for mental tranquility to invite sleep. And sometimes, even the pills are a failure. Consequently, the result of having accumulated money by so much labor is certainly not happiness, but only distress. What is the value of acquiring a comfortable position if one's mind is always disturbed? Narottam Das Thakur has therefore sung, Samsara bishanale diba nishi hiya jive jale dutaiti na kainu opaya. Quote, I am suffering from the poisonous effects of material enjoyment. Thus, my heart is always burning and almost on the verge of failure. End quote. The result of the greedy capitalist's unnecessary accumulation of wealth is that he must suffer from a blazing fire of anxiety and always be concerned with how to save his money and invest it properly to get more and more money. Such a life is certainly not very happy, but because of the spell of the illusory energy, materialistic persons engage in such activities. As far as our Krishna consciousness movement is concerned, we are getting money naturally by the grace of God by selling our literature. This literature is not sold for our sense gratification. To spread the Krishna consciousness movement, we need so many things, and Krishna is therefore supplying us the requisite money to advance this mission. The mission of Krishna is to spread Krishna consciousness all over the world, and for this purpose, we naturally must have sufficient money. Therefore, according to the advice of Srila Rupa Goswami, we should not give up attachment to money that can spread the Krishna consciousness movement. Rupa Goswami says in his Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 12.256, Prapanchikantaya Buddhya Hari Sambani Vastuna Mumukshibi Parityago Vairagyam Phalgu Kartite. Quote, when persons eager to achieve liberation renounce things which are related to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, though they be material, this is called incomplete renunciation. End quote. Money that can help in spreading the Krishna consciousness movement is not a part of the material world, and we should not give it up thinking that it is material. Srila Rupa Goswami advises, Anasaktasya Vishayan Yatar Tam Upayanjata Nirbanda Krishna Sambande Yukta Varagamuchite. Quote, when one is not attached to anything, but at the same time accepts everything in relation to Krishna, one is rightly situated above possessiveness. End quote. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 12.255. Money is undoubtedly coming in great quantities, but we should not be attached to this money for sense gratification. Every cent should be spent for spreading the Krishna consciousness movement, not for sense gratification. There is a danger for a preacher when he receives a great quantities of money, for as soon as he spends even a single cent of the collection for his personal sense gratification, he becomes a fallen victim. The preachers of the Krishna consciousness movement should be extremely careful not to misuse the immense quantities of money needed to spread this movement. Let us not make this money the cause of our distress. It should be used for Krishna, and that will cause our eternal happiness. Money is Lakshmi, or the goddess of fortune, the companion of Narayan. Lakshmiji must always remain with Narayan. Then there need be no fear of degradation. Text 33. Those who are considered materially powerful and rich are always full of anxieties because of governmental laws, thieves and rogues, enemies, family members, animals, birds, persons seeking charity, inevitable time factor, and even their own selves. They are invariably afraid. Purport. The word shvasmat means, quote, from oneself, end quote. Because of attachment for money, the richest person is even afraid of himself. He fears that he may have locked his money in an unsafe manner or might have committed some mistake. Aside from the government and his income tax, and aside from thieves, even a rich man's own relatives are always thinking of how to take advantage of him and take away his money. Sometimes these relatives are described as shvajanaka dasyu, which means rogues and thieves in the guise of relatives. Therefore, there is no need to accumulate wealth or unnecessarily endeavor for more and more money. The real business of life is to ask, quote, who am I, end quote, and to understand oneself. One should understand the position of the living entity in this material world and how to return home back to Godhead. Text 34. Those in human society who are intelligent should give up the original cause of lamentation, illusion, fear, anger, attachment, poverty, and unnecessary labor. The original cause of all these is the desire for unnecessary prestige and money. Purport. Here is the difference between Vedic civilization and the modern demoniac civilization. Vedic civilization concerned itself with how to achieve self-realization, and for this purpose, one was recommended to have a small income to maintain body and soul together. The society was divided into Brahmanas, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas, and Shudras, and the members of this society would limit their endeavors to meeting their minimum demands. The Brahmanas, in particular, would have no material desires. Because the Kshatriyas had to rule the people, it was necessary for them to have money and prestige. But the Vaishyas were satisfied with agricultural produce from the milk of the cow, and if by chance there were excess, trade was allowed. The Shudras were also happy, for they would get food and shelter from the three higher classes. In the demonic civilization of the present day, however, there is no question of Brahmanas or Kshatriyas. There are only so-called workers and a flourishing mercantile class who have no goal in life. According to Vedic civilization, the ultimate perfection of life is to take sannyas, but at the present moment, people do not know why sannyas is accepted. Because of misunderstanding, they think that if one accepts sannyas to escape personal responsibilities, but one does not accept sannyas to escape the responsibility of to society. No one accepts. Generally, one accepts sannyas as the fourth stage of spiritual life. One begins as a brahmachari, then becomes a brahasta, vanaprastha, and finally a sannyasi, to take advantage of the duration of one's life by engaging oneself fully in self-realization. Sannyas does not mean begging from door to door to acquire money for sense gratification. However, because in Kali Yuga, people are more or less prone to sense gratification, immature sannyas is not recommended. Srila Bhagaswami writes in his Nectar of Instruction, Atyahara prayasascha prajalpo niyamagraha jana sangascha lolyam cha sabhir bhaktir vinasyati. Quote, one's devotional service is spoiled when he becomes too entangled in the following six activities. Number one, eating more than necessary or collecting more funds than required. Number two, over-endeavoring for mundane things that are very difficult to obtain. Number three, talking unnecessarily about mundane subject matters. Four, practicing the scriptural rules and regulations only for the sake of following them and not for the sake of spiritual advancement. Or rejecting the rules and regulations of the scriptures and working independently or whimsically. Five, associating with worldly minded persons who are not interested in Krishna consciousness. And six, being greedy for mundane achievements. End quote. A sannyasi should have as an institution meant to preach Krishna consciousness. He need not accumulate money for himself. We recommend that as soon as money accumulates in our Krishna consciousness movement, 50% of it should be invested in printing books, 50% for expenditures, especially in establishing centers all over the world. The managers of the Krishna consciousness movement should be extremely cautious in regard to this point. Otherwise, money will be the cause of lamentation, illusion, fear, anger, material attachment, material poverty, and unnecessary hard work. When I was alone in Vrindavan, I never attempted to construct mats or temples. Rather, I was fully satisfied with the small amount of money I could gather by selling back to Godhead, and thus I would provide for myself and also print the literature. When I went to foreign countries, I lived according to the same principle, but when Europeans and Americans began to give money profusely, I started temples and deity worship. The same principle should still be followed. Whatever money is collected should be spent for Krishna, and not a farthing for sense gratification. This is the Bhagavat principle. Text 35. The bee and the python are two excellent spiritual masters who give us exemplary instructions regarding how to be satisfied by collecting only a little and how to stay in one place and not move. Text 36. From the bumblebee, I have learned to be unattached to accumulate money. For although money is as good as honey, anyone can kill its owner and take it away. Purport. The honey collected in the comb is taken away by force. Therefore, one who accumulates money should realize that he may be harassed by the government or by thieves or even killed by enemies. Especially in this age of Kali Yuga, it is said that instead of protecting the money of the citizens, the government itself will take away the money but with the force of law. The learned Brahmana had therefore decided that he should not accumulate any money. One should own as much as he immediately needs. There is no need to keep a big bank balance at hand, along with the fear that it may be plundered by the government or by thieves. Text 37. I do not endeavor to get anything, but I am satisfied with whatever is achieved in its own way. If I do not get anything, I am patient and unagitated like a python, and lie down in this way for many days. Purport. One should learn detachment from the bumblebees, for they collect drops of honey here and there and keep it in their honeycomb. But then someone comes by force and takes all the honey away, leaving bumblebees with nothing. Therefore, one should learn from the bumblebee not to keep more money than one needs. Similarly, one should learn from the python to stay in one place for many, many days without food and then eat only if something comes in its own way. Thus, the learned Brahmana gives instructions gained from two creatures, namely the bumblebee and the python. Text 38. Sometimes I eat a very small quantity and sometimes a great quantity. Sometimes the food is very palatable and sometimes it is stale. Sometimes prasad is offered with great respect and sometimes food is given neglectfully. Sometimes I eat during the day and sometimes at night. Thus I eat what is readily available. Text 39. To cover my body, I use what is available, whether it be linen, silk, cotton, bark, or deerskin, according to my destiny, and I am fully satisfied and unagitated. Text 40. Sometimes I lie in the surface of the earth, sometimes on leaves, grass, or stone, sometimes on a pile of ashes, or sometimes by the will of others, in a palace on a first-class bed with pillows. Purport. The learned Brahmana's description indicates different types of births, for one lies down according to one's body. If someone takes birth as an animal and sometimes as a king, sometimes when he takes birth as an animal, he must lie down on the ground. When he takes birth as a very king or very rich man, he is allowed to lie in first-class rooms with huge palaces decorated with beds and other furniture. Such facilities are not available, however, at the sweet will of the living entity. Rather, they are available by the supreme will, prachaya, or by the arrangement of maya. As stated in Bhagavad Gita 1650 or 1861, Ishvara sarvabhutanam hridyesho jarnatisthati, brahmanyan sarvabhutani yantarudrani maya. Quote, the Supreme Lord is situated in everyone's heart, O Arjuna, and is directing the wanderings of all living entities who are seated and as on a machine made of the material energy, end quote. The living entity, according to his material desires, receives different types of bodies, which are nothing but machines offered by material nature according to the order of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. By the will of the Supreme, one must take different bodies with different means for lying down. Text 41. O my Lord, sometimes I bathe myself very nicely, smear sandalwood pulp all over my body, put on a flower garland, and dress in fine garments and ornaments. Then I travel like a king on the back of an elephant or on a chariot or horse. Sometimes, however, I travel naked, like a person haunted by a ghost. Text 42. Different people are of different mentalities, therefore it is not my business either to praise them or to blaspheme them. I only desire their welfare, hoping that they will all agree to become one with the Super Soul, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna. Purport. As soon as one comes to the platform of Bhakti Yoga, one understands fully the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudeva, is the goal of life. Vasudeva Sabhamiti Sabhamasadulabha. This is the instruction of all the Vedic literatures. Vedascha Savaram Vavedya Sarva Dharman Prajajama Mikam Sharanam Vaja. There is no use in praising someone for material qualifications or blaspheming him for material disqualifications. In the material world, good and bad have no meaning, Because if one is good, he may be elevated to a higher planetary system, and if one is bad, he may be degraded to lower planetary systems. People of different mentalities are sometimes elevated and sometimes degraded, but this is not the goal of life. Rather, the goal of life is to become free from elevation and degradation and take to Krishna consciousness. Therefore, a saintly person does not discriminate between that which is supposedly good and supposedly bad. Rather, he desires for everyone to be happy in Krishna consciousness, which is the ultimate goal of life. Text 43. The mental concoction of discrimination between good and bad should be accepted as one unit and then invested in the mind, which should then be invested in the false ego. The false ego should be invested in the total material energy. This is the process of fighting false discrimination. Purport. This verse describes how a yogi becomes free from material affection. Because of material attraction, a karmi cannot see himself. Jnanis can discriminate between matter and spirit, but the yogis, the best of whom are bhakti yogis, want to return home, back to Godhead. The karmis are completely an illusion. The jnanis are neither an illusion nor in positive knowledge, but the yogis, especially the bhakti yogis, are completely on a spiritual platform. As confirmed in Bhagavad Gita 14:26, Mam chiyo vyabhachari na bhakti yogena sevate, sagunan samatityai tan brahma bhuyai kalpate. One who engages in full devotional service, who does not fall down under any circumstance, at once transcends the modes of material nature and thus comes to the level of Brahman, end quote. Thus, a devotee's position is secure. A devotee is at once elevated to the spiritual platform. Others, such as jnanis and hatha yogis, can only gradually ascend to the spiritual platform by nullifying their material discrimination on the platform of psychology and nullifying the false ego by which one thinks, quote, I am this body, a product of matter, end quote. One must merge the false ego into the total material energy and merge the total material energy into the supreme energetic. This is the process of becoming free from material attraction. Text 44. The learned, thoughtful person must realize that material existence is illusion. This is possible only by self-realization. A self-realized person who has actually seen the truth should retire from all material activities being situated in self-realization. Purport. By an analytical study of the entire constitution of the body, one can surely come to the conclusion that the soul is different from all the body's material constituents, such as earth, water, fire, and air. Thus, the difference between the body and soul can be realized by a person who is thoughtful, manisi or muni. And after this realization of the individual's spiritual soul, one can very easily understand the supreme spirit soul. If one thus realizes the individual soul is subordinate to the supreme spirit soul, he achieves self-realization. As explained in the 13th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, there are two souls within the body. The body is called kshetra, and there are two Chaitanyas, or occupants of the body, namely the Supersoul, Paramatma, and the individual soul. The Supersoul and the individual soul are like two birds sitting on the same tree, the material body. One bird, the individual, forgetful bird, is eating the fruit of the tree, not caring for the instructions of the other bird, which is only a witness to the activities of the first bird, who is his friend. When the forgetful bird comes to understand the supreme friend who is always with him and trying to give him guidance in different bodies, he takes shelter at the lotus feet of that supreme bird. As explained in the Mahathi, in the yoga process, dhyanavastita tadgatena manasa pashyanti yogina, yogina. When one actually becomes a perfect yogi by meditation, he can see the supreme friend and surrender unto him. This is the beginning of bhakti yoga, or actual life in Krishna consciousness. Text 45. Prahlad Maharaj, you are certainly a self-realized soul and a devotee of the Supreme Lord. You do not care for public opinion or so-called scriptures. For this reason, I have described to you, without hesitation, the history of my self-realization. Purport. A person who is actually a devotee of Krishna does not care about so-called public opinion and Vedic or philosophical literatures. Prahlad Maharaj, who is such a devotee, always defied the false instructions of his father and the so-called teachers who were appointed to teach him. Indeed, instead, he simply followed the instructions of Narada Muni, his guru, and thus he always remained a stalwart devotee. This is the nature of an intelligent devotee. Srimad Bhagavatam instructs, Yajnai Sankirtana Prayayahanti Samedasa. One who is actually very intelligent must join the Krishna consciousness movement, realizing his own self as an eternal servant of Krishna, and thus practice constant chanting of the holy name of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Text 46. Narada Muni continued, after Prahlad Maharaj, the king of the demons, heard these instructions from the saint, he understood the occupational duties of a perfect person, Paramahansa. Thus he duly worshipped the saint, took his permission, and then left for his own home. Purport. As quoted in Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya 8.128, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Kiva vipra kivinyasi shudrakena nai, ye Krishna tattva veda se guru hai. A guru, or spiritual master, can be anyone who is well conversant with the science of Krishna. Therefore, although Prahlad Maharaj was a grihastha ruling over the demons, he was a paramahansa, the best of human beings, and thus he is our guru. In the list of gurus or authorities, Prahlad Maharaj's name is therefore mentioned. Svayambhur Narada Shambhu Kurara Kumara Kapilo Manu Prahlado Janako Bhishmo Balir Vayashikir Vayam Srimad Bhagavatam 6.3.20. The conclusion is that a paramahansa is an exalted devotee, Bhagavat Priya. Such a paramahansa may be in any stage of life, brahmacharya, grihastha, vanaprastha, or sannyasi, and be equally liberated and exalted. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports of the 7th canto, 13th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled The Behavior of a Perfect Person.